Good morning. I invite you all to use the prelude as a chance to prepare your hearts and minds for worship this morning. Good morning. Welcome to worship this morning. We are so glad that you are here. Invite you all a little bit later in the service to take the Ministry of Friendship pad and pass it down the pew so we can let our visitors know how glad we were that they were here this morning. We are blessed and excited to have the Reverend Nancy Meehan Yao, who is the Associate General Presbyter for Shenandoah Presbytery, come and speak and preach for us this morning. We are glad that she is here. Welcome, Nancy. A couple of quick announcements. Next Sunday, everyone is in for a delightful treat next Sunday afternoon. So next Sunday, which is February 23rd at 4 p.m., please come to support our Helper Fund Music Fest. The Helper Fund is a fund that we have at our church that we raise money for to help our neighbors who are in need with emergency services for food or for gas or electric. So it's a wonderful cause. It's a great way to help our neighbors in Winchester. But it does take funding. So next Sunday we're having a fundraiser, but like good Presbyterians, every time we come together, we will have wonderful musical performances by our choirs and some of our talented families within the congregation. We will also, after we listen to great music and have time of fellowship together, we will also have a wonderful meal, like good Presbyterians, right? So if you are able to bring a dish, a side dish, we're providing the main course. But if you are able to bring a side dish or dessert, please sign up out in the gathering space to do so. But if you are unable to bring a dish, we don't want that to defer you from coming and enjoying fellowship and music. So please come next Sunday, February 23rd at 4 p.m. Also, next Sunday is the last Sunday to register for the women's retreat. The women's retreat, you could read more information about that in the bulletin, but it is a wonderful time for the women in our congregation to get away. We go to this wonderful woods resort up in West Virginia, so it's not too far, but we come together, we study scripture, we have worship Saturday night, we have fellowship. We sometimes go on hikes, but it's a wonderful time to come together, to have fellowship with one another. And also, women, that whole weekend, we don't have to cook. So that's a plus, right? So again, sign up for that. Ends next Sunday, February 23rd, and it's a great way to come and be together. So if you have any questions about that, please feel free to chat with me or Amy or any other woman who has ever gone on the women's retreat will be able to tell you how much fun we've had before. And that's kind of a good segue. Retreats are fun. Camp is wonderful. How many of y'all have ever been to a camp? I knew I liked this congregation. All right, so camp is a wonderful time. So we are happy to have Steph Walker with us this morning from Ligonier Camp to tell you a little bit more about fun summer opportunities.
Good morning, everyone. It's good to be here with you this morning. I have been able to come to this church every year that I've worked at camp. I think this is my 9th visit, which is amazing. I joked earlier that it does feel like a mathematic impossibility because I'm still 24, so I don't know how that's possible. I'm sure you are all 24 too. I don't know how we're doing it, but we are. It's so good to be here. I already got to share at the 8:30 service and go around to all the Sunday school classes and share a little bit about who we are. So this is me inviting you into our ministry in some really key ways. I'll share briefly who we are. We have 4 core values: Christ, community, challenge, and creation. We say that those are the 4 most important areas that somebody can be growing in their time, in their walk while they're at camp. So no matter who you are, whether you're on staff, whether you're a retreat group or a camper, we want everybody who comes in contact with Ligonier Camp to grow in those 4 important areas. We do that in the lives of kids through things like Bible study and scripture memory and songs and speakers who share about their walk with Christ. We want them to grow in community with each other, to make new friends and bring friends along, learn how you serve one another, take care of one another, love each other. We want them to challenge themselves, to do things they never thought they could do before. For some kids, that's just going to camp, right? The idea of going away, staying not in their familiar home, can be a great challenge to see them grow in their self-confidence and their awareness of who God has called them to be. For other kids, those challenges are things like going off the zip line, or going tubing behind a jet ski, or going down the water slide. Those are really fun challenges, and ones that we really want to reel your kids in with because they're very appealing. And then the last thing is we want kids to experience God's creation. We have an incredibly creative God who has given us a world that is beautiful. We want to teach kids how to be good stewards of it, to pay attention to it, and to learn more about it. A major way that we do that is we say, don't bring your phone to camp. There are no electronics for our kids when they come to camp so that they get to really enjoy God's creation. So if that sounds something interesting to you, there are a couple things you can do. Number one, you can talk to me or you can talk to Annie. We have a program that this church is doing where rising seventh graders through 10th graders can go spend a week together as a church group at camp. We also run programs for kids as young as 6 all the way up to 17 to come do as little as 2 nights to 2 weeks of camp. So lots of opportunities there. I would just ask for your continued prayers. It's so fun to partner with a church that sees the mission field as something that is in the hearts of your youth and your children. Please be praying for us as we get ready for this summer. Be praying for us as God is calling the right summer staff. That's one of the number one challenges we face every year, is to have qualified college students come share the word of Christ with kids. So we ask for your prayers. We ask for your support in that way. Thanks again for just being such a hospitable church to come to and share what we're doing. It means a lot. So thank you very much.
Thanks, Steph. Are there any other additional announcements this morning? Then I invite us all to use our introit as a chance to prepare our hearts for worship. Please join me in the call to worship. Happy are those who walk in the way of the Lord,
who seek God with their whole hearts.
Thank you.
fall short from God's mercy and grace, but we can approach God in confidence as we come before him and confess our sins against God and neighbor. Let us pray. God of mercy, who has compassion for the lost and the least, in disbelief and denial, we ask, when did we see you among us? We have closed our eyes to the needs of the world. We have turned our backs to our sisters and brothers. We have turned our hearts inward instead of opening our hands to others. Forgive us, Lord. Break our hearts for what breaks yours, and give us compassion and courage to respond to the suffering of this world. Amen. Amen. Friends, hear the good news. The saying is sure and worthy of full acceptance, that Jesus Christ came into the world to save sinners. He himself bore our sins and his body on the cross, that we might be dead to sin and alive to all that is good. Friends, in Christ and in Christ alone, we are forgiven. Amen. Please be seated. Friends, invite you all to listen to an intergenerational moment by Mr. Todd.
All right. So today we are talking about sheep and goats. Sheep on my right, goats on my left. No, it's not that way. But thinking about these two types of creatures. And so we can look at the pictures and recognize that they are different. They don't look the same. But I think what Jesus is talking about is not the difference in how they look, but the difference in how they act. And that's kind of where he goes with this. So a shepherd would have no problem splitting sheep into one group and goats into another. But Jesus talked about himself being the one who would split people into groups by different criteria. By those who helped and cared about others, and those who did not help and didn't care about others. It would be easy for him because it's obvious to know by our actions which group we fall into. And so, of course, Jesus wants to be the ones that help. And in his way of describing this, that was the sheep group. He wants us to be sheep. And so as we think later in the service about big ways to be part of that, I want us to think in just small ways how we can be sheep, how we can be people who help every day, that we can have a sheep day rather than a goat day. And maybe it looks like this. Maybe it's every day being able to say something like, I'll share mine with you, or here, this is for you. Maybe it's, I thought you might be lonely, so I came to see you. Maybe it's, I think this will help you. Maybe it's, I've been praying for you. Or, you need this more than I do. Maybe it's, I want to use my free time to help someone else. These are the things that Christ wants us to be doing and saying and thinking. That's where Christ wants our focus to be, in the ways that we can care for others and love others. And so the best part of it is, of course, there's joy that we find when we help someone else, but it's not just that we are helping that person that we serve. Jesus said, every time you help someone else, it's like you're helping me. And so we can think about that as every time we do a kind deed for someone else, every time we provide for them, we're doing that for Jesus. We're putting a smile on the face of Jesus every time we serve one of his children. So that can be our goal as we seek to put many smiles on Jesus' face. Join me in a word of prayer. Let's pray.
Dear Jesus,
you want us to help others. And we know
that is what we must do.
Help us put others
ahead of ourselves.
Amen. Thank you all for joining us.
Invite you all to stand and share the peace of Christ with one another.
Good morning. It is a deep blessing and a pleasure to be with you and join you in worship this morning. I am the Reverend Nancy Meehan Yao. I serve as Associate General Presbyter for Shenandoah Presbytery. And I always say that that job title tells you absolutely nothing of the work that I do. You wouldn't know if you read that on a piece of paper on my business card, what I do. My work is to act as support and resources for congregations, for sessions, and for their pastors, particularly but not exclusively in the areas of faith formation, stewardship and finance, ministry and outreach, and the one other area that pervades our whole life, which is change. Some of you are laughing. We know that the world outside the church doors has changed and is changing and will continue to change. And we in the church struggle with change, right? We worship a God who we say is unchanging, immovable, infinite. But I also want us to remember that in the midst of change that the church is doing, and in the midst of the change that the world is doing, and in the midst of us being church and trying to figure out what God is calling us to be and do now in this ever-changing landscape, we worship a God who is all about change. In the beginning, when God began creating, the earth was dark and void. And I know you know the story, so join in. And God said, and there was light. And that was the first change. The prophet Isaiah says to us, behold, do you not see it? says God to us. I am doing a new thing. We say that in Christ we are transformed. The old is gone, the new has come. And in Revelation, Jerusalem comes, adorned as a bride, changed, made whole and restored. If we worship a God who is all about change, then we can take comfort in times that are changing and know that God is in the midst of that change. If I can be of resource or help to your session, to your pastors, to your congregation in any way, please feel free to contact me. The presbytery is not the office down in Harrisonburg. The presbytery is the body of Christ as it is gathered in this area, in the valley, in two parts of West Virginia, as we all seek to serve the risen Lord. So again, I thank you for allowing me to join you in worship. I have a correction. It is entirely my fault. The scripture this morning will be Matthew 25, beginning at verse 31, going on through verse 46. Let us pray. God, pour out your Spirit upon us, that as we hear your word proclaimed and read and sung, it will take root in our hearts. And it will grow, and it will bear fruit for your kingdom through Christ our Lord. Amen. Our first scripture comes from Hebrew scripture, from the prophet Micah, beginning in chapter 6, verse 6. With what shall I come before the Lord and bow myself before God on high? Shall I come before God with burnt offerings, with calves a year old? Will the Lord be pleased with thousands of rams, with 10,000s of rivers of oil? Should I give my firstborn for my transgression and the fruit of my body for the sin of my soul? He has told you, O mortals, what is good, and what does the Lord require of you? But to do justice and to love kindness and to walk humbly with your God. And our gospel reading this morning comes to us from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 25. It is indeed the story of the sheep and the goats. You might note in some of your Bibles, the heading on it is named The Judgment of the Nations. When the Son of Man comes in his glory and all the angels with him, then he will sit on the throne of his glory. And all the nations will be gathered before him, and he will separate people one from another, as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. And he will put the sheep at his right hand and the goats at his left. Then the king will say to those at his right hand, "Come, you that are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you, prepared from the foundation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you welcomed me. I was naked, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you took care of me. I was in prison, and you visited me." Then the righteous will answer him, "Lord, when was it that we saw you hungry and gave you food, or thirsty and gave you something to drink? When was it that we saw you as a stranger and welcomed you, or naked and gave you clothing? And when was it that we saw you sick or in prison and visited you?" The king will answer them, "Truly I tell you, just as you did it to one of the least of these who are members of my family, you did it to me." Then the king who sits on the throne will say to those at his left hand, "You that are accursed, depart from me into eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry and you gave me no food. I was thirsty, and you gave me nothing to drink. I was a stranger, and you did not welcome me. Naked, and you did not clothe me. Sick and in prison, and you did not visit me. Then they will answer, Lord, when was it that we saw you hungry or thirsty, or a stranger or naked or sick or in prison, and we did not take care of you? Then he will answer them, truly I tell you, just as you did not do it to one of the least of these, you did not do it to me. And these will go away into eternal punishment, but the righteous into eternal life. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. This past year, Shenandoah Presbytery voted to become a Matthew 25 Presbytery, which is a national initiative launched by the PCUSA. And this initiative, this work for the whole church, is based on these challenging texts found in chapter 25, the Gospel according to Matthew, which has in it three stories. The parable of the bridesmaids, about the need to always be ready. The parable of the talents, about using wisely the gifts that God has given us. And the parable of the king who sits on the throne of judgment, the passage we heard today. The gospel writer Matthew gives us this view of the end of time, in which the nations will be judged. Now, I imagine that some of us have heard this story already, and you heard it earlier in the intergenerational moment for ministry. It is sometimes called sheep and goats. And it is about how people are divided, some to eternal life, some to outer darkness. And the reason for dividing up and either welcoming in or casting out is how people have behaved, how they have treated others. Character, they say, is how we behave when no one is watching. The sheep in this story are surprised, shocked even, to find out about their reward. We might imagine them saying, what? Of course you feed people. Of course you clothe them and shelter them and visit them. It doesn't matter who they are. It's just what you do. And the goats say to the king, who we know as Jesus, when confronted with their lack of care for others, do sort of a slimy bit of cozying up. They might have said, well, Jesus, obviously, Jesus, if we had known it was you, we certainly would have fed you and clothed you and visited you. Part of our struggle with this challenging story is that we as Presbyterians don't understand that our salvation depends on works of righteousness. That it is not our actions that save us, but it is grace by faith through which we are saved. And even that is not our own doing, it is the Lord's doing. And that's true. But the gospel writer Matthew is writing to a group of people in the earliest church, and he is trying to help them see what life in the kingdom of heaven is like, and how that looks right here and right now. A life that includes faithful readiness, that includes wise use of God's gifts, and extravagant sharing and radical rescue. I know that this congregation, like many others in Shenandoah Presbytery, are already engaged in those works of mercy, right? Feeding people, housing people, partnering with CCAP and Watts and Habitat, Rise for Hunger yesterday, a fundraiser to have an emergency fund for people in need. Some of us partnering with this church and other churches go to Ethiopia or serve the rest of the world in mission and ministry. And so we might ask, aren't we already doing this? Aren't we already doing what the king sitting on the throne is asking? But I think this text challenges us even further. The Matthew 25 initiative has three foci. And the first is building congregational vitality. Well, we like that, right? We all like congregations that are healthy and vital and thriving, that have life and energy. It's when I get to the other two points that we start to get uncomfortable. Those two are dismantling systemic poverty and eradicating structural racism, all of which sound pretty political. And at this point, you're probably thinking that I have left off preaching and gone on to meddling. And you're right. Maybe I have. But so did Jesus. We get to this point about systems and societies because it is in the Bible. It is in this morning's scripture. All the nations are the ones that pass before the king on the throne of judgment. And when we have nations, we have structures that go beyond individuals. We have systems. Systems that can bring life or death. Systems that are oppressive or promote the abundant life that Jesus talks about. When we think about Jesus and the work that he did during his life, healing and feeding and blessing and restoring, we tend to see them as individual acts. A daughter brought back to life. Sight restored to a blind man. A woman healed. People fed. Sin forgiven. Outsiders and enemies welcomed to the table. What we often don't see is how in doing those things, those holy actions, Jesus is defying and overcoming pervasive systems of oppression and racism. It's a little easier to see when we think about the story of Jesus in the temple, because there he is driving out the money changers, who by their very presence and action were restricting people from drawing close to God, who were keeping people out of the temple, all on the basis of whether they could afford to come to worship or not. It is less obvious, I think, in the stories of healing and blessing, but in those simple actions, Jesus came proclaiming the reality of a new system. Earlier in the Gospel of Matthew, in chapter 5, Jesus talks to the crowd about who is blessed. We call them the Beatitudes. But the word used for blessed there more accurately is translated as greatly honored. But the people that Jesus talked about were not greatly honored in that society. And that list looks a lot like today's list: the sick, the broken, the poor, the imprisoned. And Jesus, both in his Beatitudes and here as the king who sits on the throne at the end of time, is dismantling the rules about who is honored in society, about who receives blessing in a lopsided economy, about how community is appropriately shared and lived out in the kingdom of God. We might think, Jesus, I just want to feed people, right? Politics has no place in the church, we say. That's not what I come to church on Sunday to hear, because I get that a lot all of the other hours of my week. But if one fish lands on the shore, we ask what is wrong with the fish. But when whole schools of fish began showing up on shore, we have to ask what is wrong with the water. Archbishop Desmond Tutu says there comes a point when we need to just stop pulling people out of the river. We need to go upstream and find out why they are falling in. We need to take a look at the larger scene. We need to take a wider view. I served a church that faithfully had a food ministry program for decades. And when I asked them, "Do you ever wonder why there's still a need for people to be fed? Why working people, two parents, still cannot afford to feed their kids and make their rent?" They were not going there. That was too political. Feeding is what they knew how to do. But I think the work of the church is larger than that. The king sitting on his throne says, "Just as you did not do it to the least of these, you did not do it to me." And we have to ask ourselves why people, the least of these, who are made in the image of God, who are our brothers and sisters, who the text says are members of the king's family, why are they at the bottom of the heap? And we have to ask ourselves the uncomfortable question about what place have I had in perpetuating a system that keeps things that way? And what must the church do to change all that? Did you notice that in this passage there is no statement of faith? There is no "Jesus Christ is my Lord and Savior." There is no sinner's prayer. There is no oath of allegiance. Matthew, the gospel writer, is very focused on behavior, on the way that people who have received grace through Jesus Christ are living it out in gratitude. The prophet Micah tells us that we are to do justice, that we are to love kindness, that we are to walk humbly with God. A God who comes to us, who joins us, who we know as Emmanuel, God with us. A God who is concerned about human life, and so we should be too. So we have to ask ourselves, as individuals, as congregations, as the whole presbytery, when we meet the king who sits on the throne, how will we answer his questions? Amen.
Let us pray. God of all kindness, you gave your only Son because you loved the world so much, the whole world. So, Lord God, we pray for the peace of the whole world. Move among us by your Spirit, break down barriers of fear, suspicion, and hatred. Heal the human family of its divisions and unite it in the bonds of justice and peace. Gracious and loving God, we pray for the country that we live in. Enrich our common life, strengthen the forces of truth and goodness. Teach us to share what we have, to share our resources, to share our prosperity, that those who live lives that are impoverished may pass from need and despair to dignity and joy. Loving God, we pray for all of those who suffer in body, mind, or spirit. Surround them with your love, support them with your strength, Console them with your comfort. And Lord, give them hope and courage beyond themselves. Lord, we pray for Jack, for healing. We pray for Maureen Daly, for Edward and Tony, for Carolyn Freshwater, for healing, for Pastor Dan as he continues to recover. Lord, we pray also for Lisa, who has been working to take care of Pastor Dan, and all of those whom we name before you now in silence. Lord, we pray for our families, for those whom we love. Protect them at home, support them in times of difficulty and anxiety, that they may grow together in mutual love and understanding. Lord, we pray for the church. Keep us true to the gospel and responsive to the gifts and needs of all. Make known your saving power through Jesus Christ by the witness of our faith, our worship, our life, and our lights. And Lord, now with the confidence of the children of God, we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Please be seated. Friends, there are many ways to respond to God's goodness and grace, and one of those ways is by being generous. Generous with our time, generous with our talents, and generous with our money when we give through the church. It is our generosity that sustains the witness and ministry of this congregation. So let us continue to worship God by the givings of our offerings. Gracious and loving God, you have told us what is good. You have told us what you require: to do justice, to love kindness, and to walk humbly with you. Gracious God, we ask that you take these gifts of our tithes, talents, and offerings and use them to do justice, to love kindness, and to allow people to walk humbly with you. We ask all these things in your holy and precious name. Amen.